I'll make sure. Couple of announcements. First is again the moving of the party in the park to September. Ad board meeting has been moved for this month to the 25th at 6 p.m. Also, it's August, in case you forgot or hadn't noticed yet. And so the rummage sale will be held the weekend of the 20th and 21st?
Yes.
Friday and Saturday.
9 to 5,
okay, and then more details will be coming next week. Do we have any other announcements?
The pool supply list is in the
bulletin. Is in what?
The pool supply list is in the bulletin.
Oh, you put them in there, okay. Because I don't.
Oh.
I'm like, I don't remember putting it there. Yeah. All right. So the school supply list is in the bulletin. And when are we putting those together?
I need the stuff by August 15th.
Okay. So needed by August 15th.
So I get the stuff together.
I can help you with that, Karen, if you need help
back.
Okay.
Make sure you save that, and I'll put that list on the Facebook page also.
Oh. Yeah, we have some. So it starts out, each backpack will get 2 pens, 2 highlighters, a Sharpie marker, a bottle of blue stick, and regular pencil.
Wow.
So, yeah. Yep, and then you start.
Yeah. Do you have any birthdays or anniversaries this week? Two of you.
And Marcia.
All right.
And Charles, belated. This was the 27th of July. I'm right now.
All right.
Stand up so we can see the happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. It's going to take a while. Come on, settle
down. Yesterday was Barbara's birthday, and she celebrated with her school reunion class.
Oh, cool. Oh, nice.
That was wonderful.
Marcia's like, I don't remember how old I am. I had to stop counting after a while. Oh, is it?
Yes, this is my childhood church.
Okay. Want to stop moving things?
We'll still hear the Eldridge echoes off
the. All right, let's join together and sing our opening hymn number 640, Take Our Bread. We are the sun. those who are hungry, Jesus says,
"Come to me, there's more than enough for all."
To those who are thirsty, he says,
"Come and drink, it is free from the city."
Stop wasting your money on food that doesn't satisfy.
Come and you will find everything you need.
And our call to worship hymn number 114, Many Gifts, One Spirit. God of change and glory, God of change and glory, God of time and space, when we fear the future, give to us your grace. In the midst of changing ways, give us still the grace. Even more horrible about it, because as I remembered it, I'm like, how could I forget that? There is a annual like festival concert that goes on at Michigan International Speedway called Faster Horses. Five high schoolers from Michigan Center, which was a school rival of mine as I was growing up, but I also have friends who have kids who attend there. died from carbon monoxide poisoning in their trailer. So the community is in mourning and prayers for them and the kids' families. Sometimes it's all we can ask of ourselves, too.
Well, I had a wonderful trip to Mother Jim. I got to see my sisters. I haven't seen them in 2 years. And at this point in their lives, you never know if they're going to ask me these last
year.
So it was a great blessing. Have a beautiful day. Again, Lake Michigan, right on the highway.
Nice. Bring back lots of cherries and blueberries? No? Okay, let's be in a time of prayer. Claimed by Christ and filled by God's grace and hope, let us offer our prayers for the world, the church, and for all people according to their needs. Let us pray for our public officials, that they would make decisions for the benefit of those who suffer hardship and human need. God of love, hear our prayer. Let us pray for missionaries and the church's efforts to support them as they seek to further the expansion of God's saving news. God of love, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all businesses, that they would consider the welfare of all persons affected by their economic decisions. God of love, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who suffer with illness, that they would know comfort and strength as they are restored to wholeness. God of love, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the leading of the Holy Spirit to guide and direct our financial stewardship, that we might become better stewards of all God's gifts and blessings. God of love, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who mourn, that in their sorrow they might see the hope of the resurrection life in Jesus. May we have the ability to walk our earthly path as we anticipate the coming of our Savior to welcome us to that place where with all the saints we might have endless life with Christ. God of love, hear our prayer. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and eternal, hear these petitions of your faithful people as we present them before you. And by your grace, grant us those things you see that we need. And we pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, that we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's join in singing our prayer hymn number 522, Leave It There. Scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 17 through 22. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up to him and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your mother and father." And he said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these things from my youth up." Looking at him, Jesus felt a love for him and said to him, "One thing you lack. Go and sell all you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. But at these words he was saddened, and he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. The word of God for the people of God. Will you please join with me in the prayer to the Holy Spirit? Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant that by that same Holy Spirit we may be truly wise and ever enjoy your consolations. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Not long ago I was reading about a new survey study that came out that shows that I'm sure you'll all be surprised by this, but that church attendance is at its lowest point in U.S. history. I can tell by all your surprised faces that it's news to you. And that is coupled with a rise in a group that has been designated by numerous researchers, including a professor of mine, the spiritual but not religious group. And at some point in time, I think conversations need to be had. Because I understand the spiritual but not religious group. I get it. Honestly, all we have to do is watch a televangelist or listen to the terrible things that some people do to understand that. I understand that, you know, churches have hurt people. But it makes me, you know, ask the question, I want to ask them, what do you mean by religion? I mean, do you mean an institution? Because, okay, yeah, get it. I get that there are institutions that have done terrible things. Or is it something else? And the thing is, I don't know. Because no one's asked yet. So I'm going to offer up an idea of religion. And this one actually comes from Abraham Heschel, who said this, and I'm going to be paraphrasing. The root of religion is the question of what to do with our awareness of God and the moreness of life. If I could abbreviate that a little bit, it would be that the root of religion is the question, what do we do now that we believe? So let me unpack that in a couple different ways with a couple different examples. So Moses encounters a burning bush, right? What's the first thing the burning bush says? Moses. And then there is Moses' awareness of who it is, right? What's that?
I said, is I am who I am, the second thing.
Oh, no, it's like fourth or fifth. No, that's okay. And so Moses comes to an awareness of who it is. And then throughout the conversation, you'll notice that there is, after the calling and the recognition or awareness of God, there is then the assignment of a task. I have seen the suffering of my people, and so I'm sending you. Go. And if you know the scripture well enough, you'll know that Moses goes through five excuses why this is a bad choice. But he goes anyway. In the calling of the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah has this vision of heaven. God's asking, whom shall I send to send my message? And Moses, and Isaiah is like, would I go, but I am a man of unclean lips, who comes from a people of unclean lips. And God says, well, here, now you have clean lips. And to which Isaiah says, then send me. And here in this text, we have the rich man, or the rich young man, as he's called in another gospel, or the rich young ruler, as he's called in Luke. And he recognizes Jesus, calls him good teacher. So he has already come to the awareness. He has recalled the commandments, but knows, by the way, that there's more to it than just the commandments. We talked a little bit about it. We talked about God's loving kindness, those actions that go above and beyond the rules, the basic rules. And he sensed that the commandments were just the basics and not really the whole thing. And so he asks, "What am I supposed to do?" And what does Jesus do? Gives him a task. Sell everything you have, give to the poor, come and follow me. In the moment when we come to, whatever you want to call it, belief, trust, wonder, awe, fear, whatever it is that we come to that makes us realize that God is, we also have a moment in there. Sometimes it's very brief and we just kind of gloss over it because we don't really like it. But sometimes in there we come to realize that everything that has been given to us, everything that we have, has actually just been given to us by God. That everything we own is everything that we owe. You shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. So in a way, God is always asking us in the same way that your mom asks you to do the dishes, right? So he's asking us, but really telling us, to do something with what has been given to us. Isaiah is given a pure tongue. Go and say these words. Moses is given all the means necessary to communicate with Pharaoh and to perform God's wonders. Go rescue my people. The rich man is given the means to help the poor, and Jesus says, do it. See, the world consists, in my opinion, in religious life, the world consists not of things, but of tasks. And the things are just the tools to accomplish the task. And each question, each task that is given us nags at us, or should, constantly. And it's individualized. Moses is told to free my people. Isaiah to speak my words. The rich man to give to the poor. We all have been given our kind of individual tasks. And we as individuals are the only ones who can answer that. So the only thing really left to us is a choice. To answer, like Moses and Isaiah, and say, here I am. Or to refuse to answer. Like the rich man who went away grieving and saddened. And it's your choice. There are a couple of caveats in here. One of them is that we can kind of become numb to the nagging. Kind of that nagging feeling within us. I mean, there are plenty of examples of this in our lives. Like the buzzing of fluorescent lights. Do you ever notice that you don't notice those? Until someone tells you to, and then you're like, oh yeah, that is buzzing. Or when you're wearing glasses and they're not on you, and then you're like, where are they? All of a sudden. Or you're wearing them and you're like, where are they? But they're actually on your face. Ever done that?
Or on the top of your head.
Or on the top of your head. So we can become numb to those things just because of time. And our kind of setting them off to the side. Just wait for it to go away. Wait for it to go away. Wait for it to go away. And that, by the way, I think constitutes refusal of the task. And I think that kind of ignorance, going with the root word of ignorance, which is to ignore, that kind of ignorance usually arises when the things that are meant to be the tools for the task are deemed the real goal. And sometimes, of course, people will not recognize what they have as gifts. Jeff Bezos. Or maybe they really never came to a place of belief in the first place. But when you recognize that you're being asked something, this is the decisive moment. You have two paths. You can give in to this kind of existential moment of despair, or this acceptance of your own bankruptcy, like the rich young ruler who just basically does this. Knows he's doomed. And it's interesting to me, really, that this seems to be where most Christian theology begins and ends. Because there's nothing wrong with understanding, recognizing our own sinfulness, our own bankruptcy. But it seems to me that most Christianity begins and ends with, I'm a sinner, Jesus died for me, I'm saved, the end. Or, in this decisive moment, we can do the exact opposite. We can come to the realization of our own spiritual power, which is the power to heal what is broken in the world. We can come to the realization of our very real capacity to answer God's question of us. And still say, I'm a sinner and Jesus died for me and I'm saved, which basically means rescued from death, which means I'm alive now, so I am alive so that I can do something. a lot of times the scripture gets used to just point out that sell everything and give to the poor. But that was this guy's call. Peter's call was to put down your nets, stop being fishermen, and come be fishers of men. So the question, your personal question, is before you and always has been from the moment that you realize that God is there. So what is your answer? Are you saddened? And do you hang your head and walk away from it grieving? Or do you say, here I am? I think in many ways, this meal here is the perfect example of that. I mean, there in Gethsemane, Jesus is struggling, right? Take a cup away from him. But he still says yes to the call. He still takes the bread there at that last meal and blesses it. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth food from the earth and breaks it, gives it to his disciples and says, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this as often as you eat it and remember me. And when the supper was ended, he takes the cup and he blesses it. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth fruit from the vine. And he gives it to his disciples. He says, take, all of you, and drink of it. This is the cup of my blood, poured out for you and for the many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it, and remember. Let us pray. Lord God, as we stand before you throughout our whole lives asking, what must we do to inherit eternal life? You ask us not just to have faith, but to be faithful. To serve you in this place in whatever way, shape, and form you would have us. Not because you need us to, but because you want us to. Let your Son Jesus be our example. And let us ponder these things as you pour out your blessings and your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Amen. The table is set. All are welcome at the table of the Lord. Come, eat, drink, and remember.
I think there's a difference.
Let's join together singing our closing hymn, number 614, the For the Bread Which You Have Broken. Go now in the peace and love of Jesus Christ, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and the power of God the Father, to answer the question that is before you. Either here I am, or walk away. The choice is yours. Amen.